Hi, my name is Dave Treat. I'm here joined by Peter Hiom, who's the Deputy CEO of the Australian Securities Exchange. Peter, thanks for joining us.
You're welcome.
Tell us a little bit about the journey, both for the ASX and for you personally.
Sure. Well, I guess maybe just to start, I'll explain a little bit about my background. I've been in financial markets for all my career, in exchanges for all of my career, both in Europe and in Asia. So market infrastructure is in my blood. I understand how they operate, and I'm really interested in making them better. And I've been involved in technology to do that over many years. So I guess about 4 years ago, we were starting to think about replacing one of our pieces of market infrastructure, which is our clearing and settlement system called CHESS. CHESS has been in operation for about 20 years, about the same amount of time I've been in Australia, by the way. And that piece of technology has served us very well. But it is an old piece of technology. It runs in a programming language called COBOL, and there aren't many developers left in the world that know how that works.
They can make a lot of money if they do know.
Exactly right. But it was time for us to think about changing that technology. It happened to be at the time, though, that you might describe as peak blockchain. So that was a time when people were talking a lot about Bitcoin. They were talking a lot about the underlying technology of that Bitcoin, which is blockchain. And we really felt that it was up to us to ensure that when we were thinking about replacing CHESS, that there wasn't anything in that technology, because it sounded like it was going to solve some problems that were interesting to us, that we should understand that technology before we made a decision to replace CHESS. So that began a journey of us looking at the technology inside out, upside down, talking to a lot of people, both in the US and in Europe, to understand how that technology might be applied to us, and we came to some interesting conclusions about what it can do and what it can't do. Now, having said that, what we did find interesting about the technology was the underlying database architecture, the notion of sharing a source of truth amongst multiple parties. And it's taken us a long time over actually those 4 years to sort of boil it back to something very basic that our customers are asking of us. Mm-hmm. And so having talked about the technology and the problems we think we're solving, we think it's this simple. Our customers want richer, more accurate, real-time data. And our current technologies are not set up to deliver that to them, because we're all holding silos of information. We have a silo of data that's the source of truth, and then our customers are replicating that, and their customers are replicating, and so on and so on. And the capacity of the infrastructure to deliver a source of truth to everyone is simply not there in the way that we architect systems today. And so the database architecture of blockchain was what interested us, the ability for us to efficiently share a source of truth that you can prove to yourself is true without needing to send messages backwards and forwards to me for that purpose, which is how the systems work today. We send messages constantly to ensure that the database I have is reconciled to your database. And in that, of course, is errors, reconciliation errors that are costly for our customers. But perhaps more than that, it constrains the ability for our clients to innovate. And so one thing I would say is often people think about this as about just a cost and risk reduction. We think about this very much about real-time data unleashing some really interesting innovation. Frankly, innovations that in other industries are already, you know, commonplace, but are much more difficult in financial markets, even though we're simply moving ownership of shares from one part of a hard drive to another. If you think about it that way, you can order Nespresso pods in 4 hours, but it takes 2 days to move a record of ownership from one part of a hard drive to another. Now, we know in financial markets why it's more complicated than that, but from somebody outside financial services, they would find it odd that it seems to take us so long to do things.
I love the dialogue that I think you have championed in this ecosystem. I think is something to follow broadly, which is certainly there's a rationale and a motivation for the efficiency component,
right?
That it can drive, but that's really just the beginning. The notion of actual business model change, new products and services, and redefining the business models of how we work is on your mind and is part of the huge potential. And it's a little bit hard to foresee necessarily until we get into this shared data infrastructure.
What I would say is that, you know, the journey we've been on over a number of years to get to our thought process that this is about data sharing means that we, you know, we are taking our customers on that journey as well. So if you, when we talked about engaging with our stakeholders, which I think we underestimated in the first to begin with, but then invested an awful lot of time in explaining to our customers what we're doing, you needed to explain to them about chess and the replacement of chess, which is very much a functional concept of what could new chess do versus to old. Then you have to get them to separate the thought of chess from the platform in their mind and then talk about the platform. And then you have to get to the point of then saying, oh, but now think about if you had all of the data from not just fixed income and equities and other asset classes, now you've got the ability to use AI. And you're getting a, I feel like with AI, we're at the place we were with blockchain a little while ago, where people said, I need a blockchain.
Yeah, in purple.
I need to do something. Yes, I think there was a, I think it's been, yeah, exactly, yeah, I need it mock, yeah. I think we're sort of, we need to be doing stuff with AI, which is an early sort of expression of, we know that there's some technologies that we think can solve problems, but we need to start articulating what the problem actually is. So for us, it was, you know, reconciliation in the equity market was the start point for us. That allowed us to then start thinking about a whole bunch of other things. And yes, data analytics for us comes out of this as well, and AI and the use of machine learning and, you know, a whole bunch of things that actually have been around for a long while, but the quality of the data to apply to those tools just really hasn't been there before.
And really, the journey that getting the entire ecosystem to see the business model transformation potential and vision. I know you have invested a ton of time and energy in that, is that ecosystem, and seems to be going quite well. So I think the world is watching.
And I think that's right. And you know, and quite right too. They're watching because they should try and understand the challenges. There's some lessons we've learned on the way, and it's helpful for us to communicate those to others. But you know, I don't think there's going to be a long time before others behind us start applying the technology. Because once you get over the hump of thinking that there's something very brave about what we're doing, which I don't think is true, right? I mean, I think it's an interesting technology that you have to understand. But as I say, once you break it down and say, what are you actually doing here? Then you're actually using a bunch of proven technologies and concepts. You know, there's PKI infrastructure that's used, that's been around forever. There's databases, they've been around forever. Yeah. The blockchain, once you understand that, is clever, but you know, this is the notion of distributing a database is not in itself new. It's just the whole architecture. Once you get past that, I think you'll get other market infrastructures who will also say, apps, this is a problem we can apply that to. They may not have the same use case as us because they may not be at the same cycle in their own technology refresh. But you know, it's important for us that not only we build an infrastructure with an ecosystem, but then that ecosystem can extend into other jurisdictions. That becomes interesting. I think the interesting work you guys are doing around interoperability is important because we've got customers in different jurisdictions. Sorry, customers who span different jurisdictions who want to know that if they're going to do something in Sydney, that that's also going to work in another financial market infrastructure. Or that at least if they're different technologies that they can actually interoperate. It's a bit like making sure that we're not on Betamax when someone else is on VHS or vice versa, that actually everything can work on either.
Yes. Well, congratulations on the journey. I think the ability for all of us to learn from your example and the leadership and the experience and the thoughtful approach that you're taking, I think is really immeasurable. I mean, it's a boon to the whole progress of DLT as a concept, and is not just being looked at by other financial market infrastructures. I think you're serving as an example to, you know, multiple industries who are really contemplating, what does it mean if I actually think about tackling the heart of my infrastructure with this capability, right, instead of the, you know, adjacency or small use case. So, you know, we're very impressed and with the journey, and appreciate you taking the time with us.
No, you're welcome. Thanks very much for the opportunity to have a chat with you. I really enjoyed it.
Good. Cheers. Thank you.